Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Wojciech Szczerba. I'm a rector president of Evangelical School of Theology in Wroclaw, Poland. It is an ecumenical school in which we believe in open theology, in a dialogue going beyond doctrinal boundaries. So we want to listen to the main questions which are asked in our societies and to learn from various people of faith and wisdom. In this series, we're reflecting on the fundamental question of the meaning of Christianity in the 21st century, in the age of anxiety. And it is my honor to introduce our special guest, Professor Tomáš Halík. Thank you very much for accepting my invitation.
Thank you for inviting me.
I think you're very brave. let me say a few words about Professor Halík. He's a great priest, theologian, philosopher, psychologist, pastor, and most of all, a wonderful human being. He's a professor of sociology and religious studies at Charles University in Prague. He also serves as a president of Czech Christian Academy and a rector of the Academic Parish at San Salvador Church in Prague. Is that right, Professor Halík?
Yes, it is.
Wonderful. And during the communist times, Tomáš Halík was one of the most important voices of Czech Christianity and one of the experts of President Václav Havel. Professor Halík is an author of many books, articles, and essays. And in his publications, he often refers to the issue of reconciliation, intercultural, interreligious dialogue, systemic oppressiveness, secularization, European integration, and other important issues. And also Professor Halík has received many awards for his promotion of spiritual freedom and human rights. And I will mention just a few. In 2010, you received the Romano Guardini Prize. And then in 2012, the Knight's Cross of the Order of Merit of the Republic of Poland. And then in 2014, Templeton Prize for your work of affirming the spiritual dimension of life. Congratulations. And there is one more achievement that I would like to mention. Tomáš Halík participated in the expedition to Antarctica in 2012, and he survived. And I am very jealous of that. Well, I have to say the Templeton Prize is not that bad either. Well, Professor Halík, I'm very grateful for your thought and your writings. And I have to say, I remember the Gniezno summit in 2012. And I remember very well the triumphalistic and arrogant language of some of the bishops. And it was very difficult to accept it for me. And well, the other religions were looked down upon, and this was very sad. But then you had your lecture and you pointed that Christianity does not have to be massive in its scale. It can be, as you said, like salt, not too much, just right, to give a taste of the food. And then you stress that Christianity does not have to rule over Europe, but it needs to take care of the soul of Europe in a humble way. And I love that. And then I started reading process theology. And in your books, I found this wonderful dynamic metaphor of God, who is like the fire in the burning bush. So God is not the static metaphysical alpha male ruling over the whole reality, but it is God who is humble, who seeks to understand a person in their earthly pilgrimage and walks together with them. And then you pointed out also that the crisis of religion is the chance to find a dynamic everyday fight. And it changed a lot in my understanding of spirituality. And finally, I remember your dialogue with other religious and people of no faith. I remember your dialogue with David Cherny and your reference to believers and non-believers as seekers and dwellers. And this was beautiful. And this metaphor really helped me to relate to my own questions, my skepticism, my problems, I think. So thank you very much for that. And I can honestly say that you, Monsignor Professor Tomáš Halík, helped me to kill my religion. But you also helped me to find my faith. So thank you very much. And thank you for accepting this invitation.
Thank you, Wojciech, for your kind words. It sounds like obituary. I'm ashamed that I'm still alive. So, okay, thank you.
You're my hero, and I really appreciate your writings and your thought. And I think it helps a lot of people in Poland. I see that your books are usually bestsellers here on our not easy market. I have a few words for you, Professor Halík, if you don't mind.
Yes, of course.
Yes. So let me start with the pandemic. The pandemic that we are all experiencing at the moment. The numbers of sick people are really high in our countries, and there are many people who have died of the coronavirus, and there are also many who are suffering. Actually, you have just recovered from the coronavirus. So please tell me how to understand the situation theologically. Is it God talking to us through the pandemic? Is it God's voice somehow heard in the midst of the suffering? Mm-hmm. Or perhaps it is God's punishment?
One Jewish rabbi wrote that just a brain of a dog is unable to solve the mathematical problems, so the human brain is unable to understand the mystery of evil, especially the natural disasters. Book of Job, my beloved book in the Bible, warns to seek behind every evil and catastrophe God's punishment. And Jesus said the same several times. So in such situation, like a pandemic, I experience God more in the sacrificial and solidary love of those who seek to help others. I think God is what is unconditional and sacred and holy in our human life.
But besides COVID, there are other types of pandemics that we are experiencing. And I'm thinking particularly of the pandemic of populism and nationalism in our part of the world. And you have witnessed several conflicts in your life, including the fall of communism. And as a Czech and a citizen of the world, how do you perceive the current situation in the world? To put it simply, what has gone wrong? We can see the Brexit in Great Britain, in the US, we can see the outburst of racism, and in Central Europe, well, we can see nationalism, populism, anti-immigrant movements, anti-Semitism. In Poland, we have thousands of people protesting against the resolution of the Constitutional Court. So are we back in the autocratic system? What has the movements of Václav Havel, Lech Wałęsa achieved? What has gone wrong? I'm sorry, I have too many questions.
Yes, there are many questions. So I think that after the fall of communism and the bipolar war, the process of globalization reached its peak. And then the dark side of globalization emerged. Globalization had helped some people and some countries, especially the educated people, the people that were prepared, that were rich, to succeed. But another part of the countries, of the population in each country, rightly feel damaged by the globalization and liquid anger of those people is abused by the populists. Populism, nationalism, and fundamentalism, religious fundamentalism, but also another type of fundamentalism, are a reaction to globalization. So I think that globalization has a very important role in the fall of communism. Yes, there were many other elements, yes, the international political situation and the dissidents, but I think the globalization create a free market of goods and ideas, and this socialist systems with the planned economy and with the censorship of ideas was not able to withstand in this competition. So they capitulated. But now there is the reaction to globalization, this populism, new nationalism, fundamentalism. And I think it is the most dangerous pandemic of our time. And individual countries, societies, and churches are divided like never before. And I think very dangerous is that some populists misused the religious rhetorics and the religious emotion for this defense of identity, national identity, group identity of some political parties and so on. And we see those elements, especially in our post-communist world.
Hmm. Are you optimistic? How do you see the future?
So I always say, and we say in our country, that the optimist is a person who has lack of information. And that optimism is sometimes an illusion that the things are going better and better. And I think I'm not an optimist, but I'm a man of hope. And hope is the strength to withstand even the situation when the things are going worse and worse and are very complicated. So I'm a man of hope, not of artificial, superficial optimism.
What is the place of Christianity, and particularly of the Catholic Church, in this context? I mean, how much has it contributed to the current situation of populism, fundamentalism, nationalism?
So, unfortunately, in some countries, and I'm afraid it's especially in Poland, some parts of the church, Catholic Church, are supporting this populism and nationalism. It's tragic. It's a tragic war. I think the church should be the field hospital. It's a beloved metaphor of the Pope Francis. And I think the Pope means by this metaphor that the church should not remain in the splendid isolation from the world, but should be free of the boundaries and give help where people are physically, mentally, or spiritually afflicted and scarred. Yes, and I think this metaphor, we should reflect this metaphor. And I think if the church is to be a hospital, it must, of course, after the health, social, and charitable care, also offer some diagnosis. And be some interpretation of the current situation. So the good hospital, if the church should be the good hospital, it must also fulfill other tasks. It has a diagnostic role to play, to identify the signs of the times, and also a prevention role to create something like an immune system in the society in which the malignant viruses of fear and hatred and populism and nationalism are present, and also a reconvalescent role, overcoming the traumas of the past by the culture of forgiveness and reconciliation.
But isn't it too late? I'm thinking also of the sexual scandals in Polish Catholic Church, which are revealed in the last few months, and the scale is overwhelming, even for people like me who are not Roman Catholic. So what the church should do now, and isn't it too late?
The situation, especially in the Polish church, is very dramatic. But I think every crisis is also a possibility, a chance. And I think it's a kairos for a new beginning, to return to the gospel, to create the really new evangelization. In Poland now, some politicians like Kaczyński try to misuse the church for his attempts to create an authoritarian state. The same is Orbán in Hungary. It is very, very dangerous because it is the discreditation of Christianity, especially among the educated people and among the young generation. So the secularization process is now most rash in Europe, in Poland, and it could be something like in Ireland. This Catholic Ireland was secularized very, very rash, quickly. And but I think it's a time of new beginning, and it's a time of closing the marriage between Catholicism and Polish nationalism. So this marriage, this unit between the nationalism and Catholic Church, played a very important role in Polish history, and was very positive for the defense of identity of the Polish nation. But now I think it's time to stop it. And I think also now it's the people are discussing also the role of John Paul II, and I wrote a very wise and brave and deep reflection of Father Boniecki about this, and he said that perhaps Pope John Paul was not responsible for such of things, but we created especially after the death of the Polish Pope, from him an icon, and it was the papalatry, some idolatry of the Pope, which is unhealthy. So I knew personally John Paul II, and I admired him, but I think it was very dangerous that he was in the consciousness of the Polish nation, and especially of the Polish Catholic Church, like an idol, like an icon. And I think it's now a time behind this icon of the Polish Pope, discover Jesus and the message of the gospel again. So I think this very difficult time is also time of change, of some healing of the Polish church.
Thank you very much for this word of hope. And there have always been divisions between people, and always will be. We have, well, simply different visions and solutions and aims. We differently understand the reality around. So I'm wondering, how can we build a healthy civil society now? how can we learn to live together and learn from each other, not hate each other?
If I would know this answer for your questions, I deserve not only the Templeton Prize, but the Nobel Prize. And I think nobody has a simple answer for this difficult question. I think this division of societies and among the societies and also in the churches is really very deep. And I'm afraid of the schisma in the church. Because they are the two parts which don't understand each other. Perhaps the only solution is to seek some people on both sides. They are able to discuss and to try to understand the others, perhaps not accepting their arguments, but to understand their motives, because our statements are generally not just rational statements. They have some roots in our emotion, our private experiences, in our life stories. So if we listen these roots, this psychological context of the statements of the others, we could perhaps more understand. So they are on both sides the fanatics, and it's very, very difficult to communicate with the fanatics and with the real fundamentalists. But I hope that on both sides are also some people they are able to understand, to discuss, and we should put such a people together. So to create some platform of meeting of people of different different worldviews and political statements, and to create an atmosphere of a serious, peaceful debate. And I believe that in the future we should create such of centers of discussion, but also of meditation. You know, I think it's time for a contemplative approach to the life, and this connection between the contemplation and action. I'm afraid that this net of parishes and so on will be over very soon. I just wrote a book. I think it will be very soon in published in Polish, the time of the empty churches, and they are my teachings from the time of pandemic, which I transmitted by YouTube. When the church were closed, but also there is a meditation about the meaning of this time of empty churches. And I think it's a sign, it's a warning, it's that in many countries the churches are almost empty, and also the monasteries and the priest seminaries. And I think that this network of the parishes and so on, especially in our countries, in Poland it will be not so rush, will be over in several years, and we should create the centers of meditation and the debate, something what was the idea of the medieval universities, the universities in the Middle Ages was not a factory for diplomas. It was a community of teachers and students, community of learning, of prayer, and also of seeking the truth via free debates. And I think our parishes, our universities, our movements in the church should be such of schools of seeking the truth via debate, but also the meditation. I think it's very important because there are many people on the right side, on the left side, but we should go to the depths, and it is contemplative approach to the reality. It is a chance to have a deeper perspective and also more mature approach to our activity. And so this education is very important. The intelligent interpretation of our sacred text, then the meditation, the contemplative approach, and then also the activity in the civil society. I try to do it in our academic parish, and we have a lot of converts. You know, the people say the Czech Republic is the most atheistic country in the world, but in our university parish, I baptize myself more than 2,000 young people, and we have the 2 years of catechumenate, of the preparation of the people, and they are coming more and more, and they are open-minded, educated people. I like them very much, but they expect something more than the classical pastoral work, and there must be also a platform for thinking, for discussing, and for the meditation, and also we inspire the people for the activity in the civil society.
Thank you. What will be your message in this context of our conversation for our Polish audience, for our students? What will be your one idea?
It's something what I have said that for the Polish audience, I think it's important to recognize this very difficult time as a time of opportunity, and to go to the depth, and for a new beginning, for the return to the Holy Gospel, and to discover behind all these icons of the Polishness and so on, the real core of the Gospel. And for the students, yes, I think also what I have said, they are the temptation of extremes on the left, extremes on the right, politically, but we should go to the depths, and we should discover this contemplative approach and this new perspective, and to put our Christian witness in the civil society, in the activities, in education, in the cure and responsibility for the nature, for the ecology, and also for the moral and social ecology. So I think there are so many impulses by the Pope Francis for the reform of the church, but also for the civil society. his last document about Fratelli Tutti, the challenge and for the voice for the new brotherhood. I think it's very important, not only for the church, but for the whole community. And I think in the future there will be a clash of civilization or societas ecumenica, for a new ecumenism, which is broader and deeper. And I think all people, they feel the responsibility for the Christian values should help on this very difficult and important task.
Professor Halík, thank you very much. I think it's a wonderful idea that somehow concludes our conversation. This hope, this contemplation, and also building together civil society. Thank you very much.
Thank you for inviting me, and greetings for all the audience.
It's a pleasure and honor for us. I wish you health, most of all, and a wonderful day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.